Good morning. I'm Kate Seeley, Senior Vice President of the Middle East Institute, and I'd like to welcome you to today's panel on the future of democracy in Pakistan and Afghanistan. It's a very timely topic as Afghanistan's rival presidential candidates continue to disagree over election results, threatening potential descent into civil war in Afghanistan. On the Pakistani side, of course, the country has been rocked by protests earlier in September, leading the New York Times to run an op-ed entitled Pakistani Democracy on Its Knees. We have a fantastic group of panelists assembled here today to discuss this topic. Marvin Weinbaum, who directs MEI's Center for Pakistan Studies, will be introducing the panelists, but I just want to say a few words about Marvin. Marvin is, first of all, the moderator par excellence, who has spent decades studying and traveling around Pakistan and Afghanistan, first as an analyst at the State Department's Bureau of Intelligence and Research, and later as the director of the program in South Asian and Middle Eastern Studies at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, and he brings a unique level of knowledge and understanding to his talents as a moderator. I also want to acknowledge the sponsor of our series of panels on Afghanistan and Pakistan, Lewis R. Hughes. He's an MEI board member with a very deep interest in this area, having served between 2004 and 2005 as the chief of staff of the Afghanistan Reconstruction Group, which was created by the NSC to oversee a development in the country. So many thanks to Lewis Hughes for his generous support of this series. We'll be doing many more, so we'll keep you posted. And now I'd like to hand the panel over to Marvin Weinbaum.
Thank you, Kate. And I'm delighted that we're together discussing a topic which is on many of our minds these days. And let me say before I begin here that we have indeed a fine group of people here to comment on the questions that we're going to be looking at in this discussion. You have the biographies with you, but let me quickly anyway, just briefly, introduced Hassan Abbas here to my right. Hassan is at the National Defense University. And by the way, you may have noticed as you came in that his very recent book is available here, and I would highly recommend this book. There have been a number of books of late on this, and this is certainly among the very, very best. So if you're interested in Afghanistan and Pakistan, certainly you're interested in the Taliban, and this is a must read. So again, it'll be available outside. Sarah Chayes is here as a senior associate at the Carnegie Endowment, and Sarah has extensive experience in Afghanistan and has been really an important observer, really, of the area for a while, and we're looking forward to her remarks. And Josh White, to her right, is the deputy director of the South Asia program at the Stimson Center, a very fine institution, and Josh spent a little time in the Defense Department and has really distinguished himself in understanding particularly Islamic issues involved in the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa area, the tribal areas. And to the right of Josh is Moeed Yusuf, who's known to many of you as a mainstay at the U.S. Institute of Peace, and is director of their South Asia program. And Moeed has, of course, written extensively, is quoted very frequently. Now, the format today is going to be that we're going to have a discussion in which you'll be invited to join in on.
Eventually.
Yes. You jumped the gun there. Eventually. But we're going to have the benefit of their discussion first. And I want to begin by observing that You know, it wasn't that long ago that we were beginning to be convinced that maybe Afghanistan and Pakistan had turned a corner toward a democratic consolidation. We know how both countries have been struggling in this regard, but you had in Pakistan in May of 2014, you had an election in which, as most of you know, power was transferred peacefully, constitutionally, from one party to another. And there emerged from that a government that looked like it was in a position here to act decisively. And if not euphoria, at least there was a good sense here that Pakistan now was on the right path. Earlier this year, April to be exact, there was the first round of elections in Afghanistan. And there was a feeling that this too represented somehow a very hopeful development, in that the election had taken place, there were multiple candidates. Yes, there were some irregularities, naturally, there was some violence, but all in all, it looked like a democratic exercise here that they were going through, and that it was the first step toward bringing in Afghanistan what had occurred in Pakistan, and that is a peaceful transfer of power. Well, events most recently have cast some doubt here about whether these processes that seem to be in motion here were going to go smoothly, and in fact, questions raised about whether the countries could actually manage a democratic transition, whether this kind of exercise only led to political instability, because that's what we seem to be witnessing in both countries at the current time. Some would say that what we're seeing is really a manifestation of deeper, perhaps structural problems in both of these societies, and that this shouldn't come as a surprise at all, but it is a natural development because of these deeper problems. Others would say, no, wait a second, this is perhaps a bump along a road, a difficult road here, that they're going to take an arduous path toward a more democratic development. So with that as our context here, I'm going to open up with perhaps an obvious first question and ask the panel, just how would they describe democracy in both these countries? Are there a few words that you would use to give a description of the kind of democracy that exists there now before we go on and talk about anything further? So who'd like to open up on this? What words would you use to describe, Sarah, what words would you use to describe Afghanistan's democracy?
I'll always break the ice. I'm not quite gonna answer that, of course. What I wanna say is, what's clear in Afghanistan, and I suspect is the case in Pakistan, which I know much less well, is a gigantic demand on the part of the population for the substance of democracy, not just electoral exercises, but electoral exercises that generate, real input from the public into their collective destiny, real mechanisms for the sharing and distribution of power, and for the redress of legitimate grievances. So in both of these elections, you had gigantic voter turnouts. I think that's really important. But whether an electoral exercise, which we all put, or many people put their hopes in, translates to democracy, to this kind of substantial democracy, is really the question. The just one final point I'd make about Afghanistan, the notion that there hasn't been consolidated democracy in Afghanistan is not accurate. There hasn't been in the last 30 years. But Afghanistan does have a serious historical experience with the substance of democracy.
Your question, sorry.
Yeah, go ahead, please.
What you asked reminds me of a quotation from one of my professors, Saeed Shafkat, who had written an article in South Asia Journal titled, as regards Pakistan, a discrepancy between democratic creed and autocratic reality. Hmm. And from that, what I want to emphasize, yes, there are huge disconnects in the idea of democracy, as we understand that in the West, if I may say, and the way in which democratic institutions and democratic culture is developing in various parts of the country, ranging from Russia to many of the Middle Eastern countries to Pakistan and to Turkey, for instance. In this case, I think trying to understand what is happening in Pakistan, Afghanistan today as regards an understanding of what democracy is all about, some would spend a lot of time just thinking about Islam and democracy, whether is it our own religious context of governance, whether democracy delivers that. So some would view it from that lens. However, I think the most useful lens for us to keep in mind is that they, both countries in terms of democracy, are going through transition. And transitions are messy. If there's a lot of upheaval, that is a sign of change. And change in this case, I think, may seem a lot of some violence, some instability, some chaos. But change is in the direction of, in my view and my assessment, towards some consolidation of democracy.
Let me just, look, there are people standing in the back and we have many chairs up front here. Please, please use this opportunity to take a seat.
Is reserve being
adjourned? No. I don't know who we had in mind. Yes.
Yeah. With respect to Pakistan, I think it's important to note, even though it might be obvious to many of you, just what a remarkable consensus has emerged around the procedural aspects of democracy, and I think the value of those procedural aspects. The elections have gotten much better. There have been efforts, election after election, to tighten up ways in which elections have been abused. And I think there's an expectation on the part of the public that's a good thing, and that these procedural changes are important. There's also a very vibrant democratic political culture, which has been sort of thrashed about and beaten about at times, but it's actually remarkable, coming from many other parts of the world, even nearby, to see how vibrant the political culture is. I would say if there's a lack of consensus, it really is on how to achieve the substantive democratic gains that at least in theory everybody would agree on. And there are several different narratives that, or several different priority areas that float out there in the public domain as sort of paths to get there. You know, and we see this just in recent years. One is saying, well, we need to focus on the judiciary. The judiciary is a vehicle by which grievances can be addressed that aren't being addressed through other systems or the formal system. And you certainly saw some of this aspiration with the lawyers' movement. Another one is the sense that, well, if only we had a strong executive, we didn't have a fragmented coalition government, then we would be able to achieve some of these substantive gains. You saw that aspiration, that sense, with the election of this Nawaz government, which came in with a resounding majority. There's a view that says, well, if only over the long term we can get parliamentarians deeply involved in doing more than dispersing money to their constituents and thinking in more legislative ways and with oversight, that's a vehicle to ensuring some of the substantive democracy. There's been a whole debate about devolution. Maybe the real challenge is that government is too far away and too disconnected and needs to be devolved to the provincial levels or below. Maybe that's the avenue. I think, as Hassan said, there's this a whole other view espoused by many of the people I've spent time with in Pakistan, that Islam in general is the answer to good governance, but specifically there are aspects of Islamic finance or Islamic sort of social organization that will get you there. And then when all else fails and you're not excited about any of these, you talk vaguely about civil society as a vehicle through which sort of somehow the more sort of substantive democratic concerns can be addressed. But all that to say, I think, you know, in many ways this is not unhealthy, but there are lots of different narrative frames through which people get at this question of if you think beyond just voting and the process of voting and you want to address substantive democratic concerns, where's the right place to start? And frankly, I think it's healthy for Pakistan to have that public debate, as frustrating as it is for Pakistanis not to have feel like they've resolved it.
Moeed.
So to begin, Marvin, I mean, I think we need to be clear that we're talking of particular types of states. States which are fairly large, multi-ethnic, interrupted histories in terms of their democracies, and a fair amount of cleavage within society. My view on democracy for a number of years was very close to what Hassan has just mentioned. And over time, I've become increasingly cynical about the idea of looking at democracy as procedures. And too often in this town, we talk about democracy as procedures. And throughout, you know, saying things like elections and like procedural changes in parliament, etc. To me, there are two ways, sort of the conceptual way to look at this is that there are electocracies and then there are democracies. Electocracies are easier to bring about than democracies. And what I have found, I spent 2 weeks with these protests before I came back from Pakistan. It was actually very shocking, even to me, and I follow Pakistan on a day-to-day basis and have done this for a number of years, how deeply sympathetic, not supportive, but sympathetic people are to the idea of the need to change, overhaul, or even crash the status quo system. Nobody has an answer of what it means to crash it and what will come after that. But the sense of despondence with the status quo is extremely deep. And what people are essentially saying, to my mind, and this is not only about Afghanistan, Pakistan, I can go to other countries, democracy equals governance delivery. You do it, I'm with you. You don't, I am willing to challenge the system. The only point of disagreement in what I've heard so far where Hassan, you're right in terms of saying, you know, this Syed Shafqat sort of quote of democratic heat versus autocratic reality. I think people are despondent enough that they don't even mind autocratic ways of ruling as long as it is delivering. And so there's no data that I can give to you which is objective or which is transparent. But quite honestly, I felt that there was a time in Musharraf's tenure where he was genuinely more popular than the civilians were. That wasn't about democracy. That was about people saying, if prices are coming down, if you're delivering on X, Y, Z, I'll live with that. And that's because, you know, one of the things I often say is that the biggest enemies of democracy in these countries are poorly performing civilian governments.
This is a very important point because it raises the question whether people are really concerned with having democracy so much as good governance.
Right.
But then the question is, can you really have good governance without a representative system?
Yeah.
Sarah?
You cannot have.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think that's exactly the question, and I think we in mature democracies forget that was the objective of our founders too, was good governance. Democracy was merely a means to arrive at that end. The problem is we've gotten stuck on the means, presuming that the means will automatically produce that end. Whereas in zones from Eastern Europe after the fall of the wall, through the Arab Spring to Afghanistan and Pakistan, that has proven not to be the case. And I completely agree that in all of those places, people frustrated with the electocracy are willing to think that other modes of government might provide more of this substantial outcome that they're looking for, be it autocracy or be it religious, you know, a kind of religiously organized society. Now, the one thing I'd add to service delivery is absence of kleptocratic capture of revenues. So that's, it's not just that you're providing a school or a hospital, it's also that obviously the bulk of the national resources are not being captured by a tight-knit network of ruling elites, which is the case in both of these countries. The other thing, I just, again, not being a Pakistan person by great experience, but the military and the fact of the control of a significant amount of power by the military is also, I think, a factor that didn't really come in here.
I mean, I'd just like to defend the proceduralists a little bit. I think it's been quite a while, maybe since the 1990s, that many people really had expectations that you could introduce procedural democratic norms and elections and have reasonably good elections and expect the rest of it to fall in place. I mean, I think I really think that it is it's an exercise in setting expectations, which in the Pakistani context is part about setting expectations about the military's potential interference, but also about setting norms about how societies, especially divided societies, resolve disputes in the context of elections and a constitutional framework. That is fairly limited, but it provides, I think, a framework to deal with a lot of these other issues. And in some cases, I think it's it's one of the most important things that outside players can champion and can support. Dealing with some of the more substantive issues is sometimes possible, but I think the procedural issues are very important.
I have some data to suggest.
Two fingers here.
Okay. No, go for.
Some data to suggest, which I think this is an important point, but Moeed, I have not seen any data that suggests that Musharraf at any time was more popular than political leaders. And why I say this is a very quick glance at what was the consequence of Ayub Khan to Pakistan? Dismemberment of Pakistan. What was the gift of General Ziaul-Haq, the second military dictator? Radicalization, religious extremism, militancy, terrorism. What has been the product of General Musharraf? Another level of cleavages and because of hypocrisy and very confused policies, a new range of the rise of terrorists. You compare politicians with them, and I know that you are not making a case for dictatorships, I know well, but I'm saying that to make the argument that at any given time, dictators in Pakistan, for instance, were more popular than the politicians is a very problematic argument. Also related to this is the idea of, just one more point about democracy. The very idea of democracy, I think the procedures, the processes can always be improved, that is how it works. But the very idea of how democracy is understood has to be very clear. It is people at the center, whether we, yes, representative system through elections, so long as people are at the center of decision making, that is critical. When it is any group, whether it is judiciary, in case of Pakistan, who are the biggest challengers to democratic ideals or the idea of democracy? At times, most of the times, frankly, military. The military establishment. Increasingly, we have judiciary. Media also wants to become a player. And that, so there is some confusion. And then, of course, all the religious parties who think, no, they have some unique idea of an Islamic concept of democracy which is going to function. That very idea is at threat in case of Pakistan.
Boy. Yeah, let me take this to a different level, if I may. But before that, just to say that I want to reiterate, Hassan, that the point is not that the military regimes have done better. That's not the argument I'm making. What I'm saying is when you go to the cab driver on the street, right, you're still having a conversation in Pakistan about whether military rule or civilian rule was better, rather than having a conversation about PPP, PMLN, PTI, and not about the military. That's the only point I'm making. And that, to me, is partly a function of substantive democracy not having delivered what people hoped. Second, I think procedures are critically important. And one of the reasons nobody was talking about, or nobody seriously thought that a direct military intervention was possible in Pakistan, was because of the procedural improvements that have been made. So that's not the argument that it's not important. There is too much emphasis on procedures, though, in our kind of analysis, is the point I want to make. But let me take it to a very different level and ask a question and then try and give you at least my sense of this. What is good governance? You know, it's easy to say that substantive democracy has to do better. We get up and say, Karzai very corrupt, look, he didn't deliver, if only he had done better. We said this about Zardari in Pakistan saying, oh, corrupt, this and that. Now, Nawaz Sharif, 14 months into his government, already maligned and saying, oh, he hasn't delivered, prices are up, this and that. The question is, have we been able to define what is good enough governance for people to be patient and allow politics to continue in the way that it should for democratic consolidation to take place? Again, I think it's very easy to say somebody shouldn't be corrupt. But you are talking about countries which, first of all, have huge problems. Second, the only way they win elections is by raising expectations, sometimes unrealistically so. So they're fighting that. Third, the national pie that they're using, and I think Sarah's point about revenues is correct, is very, very small. And fourth, don't forget, they are elected primarily on the basis of patronage. And so when you're elected on the basis of patronage, as a self-serving, rational political actor, you are going to defend your patronage over and above what I and you may call national interest and good governance. So yes, Karzai, terrible, he did this and that wrong. That was his survival strategy. I'm not defending him for a second. But my point is, it's very easy to say that people should govern better. But as an analyst, I also have to open up a number of countries and present to you identical outcomes in countries where people, leaders, are not governing up to the expectations that we have. And to me, the answer can't only be these guys are corrupt, these guys are crazy, they don't know what they're doing. There is something structural about this, which we really have to think about in an era. And this is the first time democracy is being challenged in this way. In an era where information revolution has taken away the monopoly of information of the state. And so it's no longer important in terms of reality on how many numbers oppose a government. What is more important is that Twitter and media can create a perception about failure of the government much quicker than it could ever do. And so governments are boxed in a way that I think they've lost the space to make some of the toughest decisions that they could otherwise. And I'm not saying that, you know, this information revolution is bad. My point is that there are new rules to be set. And I think our analysis and these countries are behind the curve in terms of adapting to those rules to be able to govern better. Otherwise, to be honest, unless we can answer what good governance means, I can sit here actually and start defending Nawaz Sharif. I don't see him having broken the constitution for 14 months. I don't think he's done terribly badly, but it's simply not enough. He's being blamed for making appointments within his family. Absolutely, he shouldn't. Today in the papers, the first thing that I read was that he's now being blamed for appointing the attorney general who was close to Musharraf. So where do you go? You have a pool of people, you've got to pick. And so I think we need to figure out how boxed in these countries are and whether our benchmarks for good governance are too high.
Sarah?
I agree that the analysis is faulty, but I think I take almost an opposite tack to the way you do on how this analysis needs to be readjusted. I don't so much see politicians who fundamentally want to govern but are boxed in by these forces. I see something else. I think these forces are the result of a changed objective on the part of the leadership, both of Pakistan and Afghanistan. These are essentially networks. They're elite networks whose primary objective is the acquisition of revenue. That they're criminal organizations that are masquerading as governments. Their fundamental objective is the capture of revenue. Governing is a kind of front activity, and the patronage is, in fact, it's the payoffs to the members of the network who are part of this criminal network. And it's that contradiction between the pretense of government and which is sustained by things like elections and stuff like that, and the reality of what's going on, that I think is infuriating populations because they see the delta. So, for example, would any of you like to be president of Afghanistan? Raise your hand. Right. So what are these two people doing fighting over this position? It's about money. And the population is completely exasperated because their demand for real government, peopled by individuals who were trying to further the public interest and might have been confronting obstacles is being contradicted by the reality of what these elites are actually doing. And on procedures, so institutionally, what I think is really interesting is we're having elections, back to the procedure versus substance question, we're having elections when the constitutional makeup of both of these countries is contrary, makes it impossible to deliver the substance of democracy. In the case of Pakistan, it's the preponderant role of the military in the exercise of power. In the case of Afghanistan, it's an electoral dictatorship. I mean, how did the United States think that it was, quote, imposing democracy on Afghanistan when the center of American democracy is about separation of powers and checks and balances, to a fault, one might say today, and yet we created a kind of electoral dictatorship in Afghanistan. And on procedures, I'm sorry, but maybe not with respect to Pakistan, but with respect to Afghanistan, everybody forgot about 2009, and everybody shut their eyes and said, we're going to have a great election, and it's going to change everything. I mean, it was shutting their eyes, holding their nose, and diving. It was just astonishing, and I remember 2 years ago talking to not any of the three of you, but some of the Afghanistan crowd in this town, and we were trying to write something up about, you know, what to do, and some people insisted on how important the election was going to be and how we really, the U.S. government really had to focus on the election. I said, good, okay, we'll write that in. Give me three things the U.S. government has to do to try to ward off a repeat of 2009. Now, this is a different type of repeat, but it's a repeat where fraud has been the overwhelming determinant of the sort of repercussions. And nobody had an idea. No one could come up with three things that the U.S. government needs to do. And I'm like, we're fantasizing. So I actually, maybe not with respect to Pakistan, but with respect to Afghanistan, it has been blind faith in procedures.
So okay, Moeed, and then...
Just to two finger on this. I think, Sarah, we're actually saying pretty much the same thing. And let me just add another wrinkle to this, which is, one, I think Pakistan and Afghanistan may be incomparable in some of what you said, but I don't quite accept the romanticization of quote-unquote the people, because the people are also involved in that patronage network. So in Pakistan, Imran Khan's majority vote bank is coming from kids of the elite. The same elite who are actually running exactly the kind of mechanism that you've just explained. And so there's sort of an inherent paradox here, where people are preying on the system and the same people are also, along with other common people, wanting to crash the system, bring change or whatever. And the fundamental problem here is that votes are not gained by governance still. There is something else that gets governments 58% of the vote or 58% of the seats, even though they keep doing what we are saying. And so people who I argue with in Pakistan to say, look, incremental change is the only way to get out at the other end being winners. Their argument is this works where the system is not captured by patronage. When the system is captured by patronage, the same people get elected again and they keep doing things that they've been doing.
An important point here, I agree, sir, with the main gist of your argument and understanding, but why we needed Afghans to tell us three things when we are there for the last 13 years spending billions of dollars? So it is, we should have known better
Thank
than
you.
Asking Afghans.
Absolutely.
So this is also in some ways, and not you, many others have started shifting the blame of many failures on the Afghan people.
Absolutely.
Saying at the end of the day, they were not ready for democracy, they are so crude, they had no clue what democracy is, whereas some of the problems are a consequence
Absolutely.
Of some of the misreading on our part in America. Still, I think all is not lost, absolutely.
It was Americans, it was people in this town that I was asking for the three things. It was analysts.
It was not Afghans.
No, of course not.
Okay.
It was analysts here, and I'm like, you want to believe in the elections, and yet you don't have an idea for how to, you know, ensure that 2009
Absolutely, and,
yeah.
and then this been...
So I agree with you 100%.
Perfect. This general trend of blaming it on Afghans, but also about, as regards one issue, which anyone could have mentioned, was about the election commission. I'd heard from many analysts here, they were saying, yes, election, if Afghan election, sure, that the functioning of the Afghan election commission will be transparent, will be effective, then that will be one way to manage things. Still, also one, now that you have clarified one point, the other objection I have to one comment you made is about, we cannot still declare the whole of Karzai camp, not, if not Karzai camp, the Abdullah camp and the Ashraf Ghani camp to be that they're completely taken over by the criminal gangs. I mean, they're elements of criminal, they're criminal elements who are representing political parties.
I was talking about the Karzai government.
Karzai government.
Karzai
okay.
government. And I would say the elites.
Well, let's let Josh get in on this.
Just a
the elites, you know, Sioux camps.
A very brief point. Some of what Moeed is talking about is, you know, something political scientists grapple with a lot, which is, in what cases do you see a political system that's primarily oriented around clientelism and a vision by political elites that their job is to provide sort of services and kind of a barter arrangement with constituents, to a more programmatic-based political party system where parties develop broader agendas that aggregate the interests of people that they think they're trying to bring on board? This is a very complicated question, and I would say, again, in defense of proceduralism, that having a longevity of a democratic process, even just the process that puts boundaries on this being a repeated game and not a one-time or a two-time game, is a necessary, certainly not sufficient, but I think is a necessary condition to making that transition, where political parties and political actors can look over the horizon eventually and say, yeah, look, let's begin to stand for certain ideas or certain programs, because we may actually have a shot one or two iterations down the road, because there are expectations that have been built about constitutional norms and about the legitimacy that's conferred by a process. So definitely not sufficient, but I think an important part of shaping how political parties deal with this. Now in Afghanistan, the problem is that the procedural structure that was put in place at the beginning is wholly unsuited to Afghanistan and to the sort of conciliation that you would need in order to have political parties exist in any meaningful form. So I think that it looks very different in Afghanistan than it would in Pakistan.
You know, implicit in all of this is we're talking about liberal democracy much of the time.
Yeah.
Which where we have certain pre-assumptions here about what constitutes it. For example, one of these, and we've heard also about checks and balances, which is a structural issue, but many would say that you can't have a liberal democracy unless you have tolerance, unless there is a willingness to accept, and we usually, it takes the form of providing for the rights of minorities, be they electoral minorities or ethnic minorities, an inclusiveness in the system which enables it to reach a reasonable amount of stability. Is there at all an element where you could say that given the experience, the maturity of both of the electorates in these countries, that is something which has to be learned over time? It has something which takes a great deal of time to develop a certain confidence here that it's not a zero-sum game, that somehow in the end we all prosper if we accept one another and are willing, specifically in a procedural term, to wait for our turn. So I think my question is there any way when people say they're not ready for democracy, is there any element of truth here, and should we therefore have, a given the liberal context, a different set of expectations which they have met or are going to meet but would never satisfy us?
Why don't you start?
I would just say that some of my most interesting and memorable conversations in Pakistan were conversations about American, early American history, and how these analogs did or did not apply to Pakistan. I mean, we had the Massachusetts Bay Colony with a very particular vision of how sort of religion and public life should interact and how minority groups defined by the community should be treated. We had the Rhode Island Colony, which had a very sort of different conception. And this was sort of thrashed out from the very beginning in a very long and ugly way. And now we have an imperfect America in which, nonetheless, a Mormon can run for president, which is a really shocking development if you look at the sort of the sweep of American history. And you know, I worry a lot about the trajectory of the discourse in Pakistan, and sort of the narrow and narrower definition of who's in the fold, both politically but especially in religious terms. I think it's very troubling. But at the same time, I don't think that you could say that debate has to happen before a democratic process. And also not to conflate a democratic process with a sort of constitutional set of guarantees. I think Pakistan has a constitutional set of guarantees that are have a lot of holes in them, but having a process where you know, these issues can be debated, and even if the enforcement is awful, which often is in Pakistan, people can point to a certain set of guarantees as part of sort of, you know, a public debate about these things. So I guess the short answer would be that I think these things can happen simultaneously with the sort of development of a political culture, and even in Pakistan, where I worry a lot about the space narrowing, especially for religious minorities, I don't think it's right to say that they can't have those debates or resolve those debates in sort of a democratic system.
Anyone else?
As you had asked about tolerance, I think over a period of time in Pakistan, if there's any increase in tolerance, that is about incompetence, unfortunately. There's more tolerance for incompetence and for this consecutive play of various institutions. But I think the as important and as critical the example of United States history and other democratic institutions, where the processes and the systems were improving over a period of time, and there were so many forces at play. Now that we think often at times jump-starting democratic institutions, we may not have as much time to give. For instance, in case of Pakistan, where and Afghanistan as well, where ethnic cleavages are very entrenched, where religious extremism and tolerance and intolerance are very entrenched, to maybe go through that longer standard organic process. Here, if something has to be really, there has to be a boost or massive investment in something for democracy to play its role, then it is institutions. And I don't see that kind of investment in institutions, even by those players in Pakistan and Afghanistan who want democracy to flourish, which can strengthen them. For instance, one example, recently when these big protests were organized for in Islamabad, the decision of the Prime Minister, Nawaz Sharif, this is his third time in office, and he asking the military to come and defend these institutions, Parliament, National Assembly, President House, shifting this security responsibility to the military, he was kind of shooting himself in the foot in one way. He should have learned that it is his own civilian law enforcement institutions which he could have empowered. Even now, no one has taken that opportunity away from him. Same signs in Afghanistan. So my main point is investment in institutions, especially those institutions which establish state, which strengthens state, which is rule of law and related to criminal justice system. That will be one shortcut. It will, religious tolerance, education levels will take decades to come.
But isn't institutions the very sort of thing which we know take time to root? Isn't that the usual example that you've got to build institutions? Moeed?
I honestly don't have an answer except to say that we deal with too much jargon sometimes. You know, I don't know what it means to build institutions in these contexts. Mm. I don't. I've tried and tried, and I don't know what it means. You know, okay, you want to build institutions that support democracy. That essentially means you want to build everything. Right? And So police you need to invest in. I'm just taking an example. Okay,
police. Justice system.
Justice system. How do you do this? You have a patronage network. You have corruption, which is pervasive. You have I going to the Pakistani police station and asking the police to torture somebody because he stole my cell phone. I am the same person who's sitting here defending values and democracy and liberalism. There are societal contexts. You know, I am increasingly becoming allergic to the idea of absolutism in terms of understanding societies. What we have done as a universe is essentially decided that we've figured out the code to succeed. And now asked other countries, no matter which stage they're at, these are certain things that you must do. I'll give you a very simple example. I was talking to a group of Pakistani politicians and businessmen. And you know, having a conversation about business and the need for whatever. And they said, okay, fine, we take this. EU has offered Pakistan this GSP plus, which is sort of a concession to get exports in. And they've tagged along to that a abolition of death penalty in Pakistan. Now the question is that this death penalty business is not a question businessmen can answer. They can only produce things. And that's a hugely sensitive debate that you have to have in the political realm. Right? All these countries are signatories to treaties that they violate every single day. Human rights and corruption and everything else. So I guess to me it's easy to say, I mean I can give you personal examples of talking to Pakistani leaders, and quite honestly they understand completely the need for rule of law and institutions and everything. They're not dumb about this. But getting there, when they say tell me how to make it happen, these are my constraints, you know, it's easier said than done. Let me end by just, I was just jotting down as Hassan was speaking, here are the constraints for any Pakistani prime minister, any, I don't care who it is. Debt servicing, they can't change a thing. Military's budget, they have almost no control over. Patronage networks and corruption, which essentially means a bloated public sector and a huge current account deficit. Okay, all of this added together is about 65% of the national pie. Okay, so you start with 35% of the pie. Next, international obligations, whether it's this, you know, human rights treaty or this treaty or that treaty that they have to make sure they abide by, and the society and the context doesn't really allow them to do that. The incompetence we talk about. You've got to work with the human resource pool you have in your country. Whatever it is, that's where you're going to pick from. Why aren't all postings made on the basis of merit? Because there's patronage. And if you don't have patronage, you don't get elected. And thus patronage has to be internalized into this equation. Then you have terrorism, radicalization, this and that. And the final point is, again, I'll go back to this information communication revolution, which means that the state's ability to create perceptions and expectations is no longer there. And so 35,000 protesters can challenge you. You can have people throwing out things about appointments and Twitter and this and that, which is not a bad thing. But it boxes in governments in these contexts in a way that the Pakistani government could not even respond to these protests of 35,000 people by exercising even their legal rights to disperse the protesters, to arrest protesters if they did something. They couldn't do it because the state is so delegitimized, the idea of the government, and so weak that they have no space to operate. So, you know, it's easy to say, and I'm one of those who said it often, build institutions, you need to perform better. But when I open this up, it's not that simple.
I'd like to go back. I mean, again, I still have a bit of a quarrel with that and with the role of transparency, the sort of social media, which you can see in the opposite direction, that the social media is in fact exposing the reality of the criminal network. It's not that it prevents the government. I mean, yeah, it prevents the criminal network from pretending to be a government as
effectively. It's a double-edged sword, I think.
But on pluralism, let me just think on the Afghanistan context for a second. I think Afghanistan's an incredibly pluralistic society. I don't see in Afghanistan that any, the only real exception is gender. And even gender has made incredible strides. That's perhaps the one thing that's made really remarkable strides in the last decade in terms of participation, effective participation of women in public life. And I come from Kandahar. I mean, I live in the most, I think, restrictive in a lot of these ways, part of the country. But ethnicity is not an issue. It isn't. It's really about this criminality. And so when you interact a kleptocratic mode of governance with a significant identity divide, which does exist, both the impact on the population will be exacerbated. But Afghanistan is not a country that ordinarily, I mean, it intermarries. People don't go out and commit spontaneous violence against other ethnic groups. And the religious divide is non-existent, with the exception, again, of Christianity, which is irrelevant. I mean, there just aren't really any Christians. But even under the Taliban, there was a whole neighborhood in Kandahar called Hindu Chowk, which is where the mostly Sikhs, actually, but they were completely integrated into Kandahar society. Where I would talk about not ready, if you will, as I said before, Afghanistan did have a pretty consolidated democracy in the middle of the 20th century. The Soviets executed 30,000 intellectuals. So going back to the American experience, which I think is useful as an example, we were functioning despite all the differences between Rhode Island and Massachusetts and stuff like that. It was white male Protestants, right? And from a very narrow religious and educational background. And they were incredibly educated. And not just educated, they were the leadership, the elite, was a philosophical elite. It was thinking, it was steeped in thinking that had been transpiring in Northern Europe for the previous 200 years on political structures. That group of people doesn't exist in Afghanistan. So the potentials who could have been that group of people were largely executed by the Soviets. In other similar countries facing this dilemma, they've mostly been sucked into business. Because we don't live in a period of political philosophy. We live in a period where people are really interested in making money. So if you look at all the Arab elites from the Arab Spring and, you know, Afghan elites who joined the diaspora, most of them went into business. And they haven't. So that's where I think there's a very profound gap between what populations hope their government will deliver and what the leadership, the sort of elites of this country is capable of constructing in order to deliver.
Sarah, I think we're going to have a conversation about the consolidation of the Afghan system, democracy in the 50s and 60s. I think we've tended, in retrospect, understandably, to romanticize that period. I lived there during that period, and so we ought to have that conversation.
Okay,
you know,
but...
Yeah, okay. Now, and the failure, by the way, is what opened up the door for the communist takeover in the 70s. You know, upstairs just last week, Tom Friedman made a very nice, his phraseology is always remarkable.
You mean his bumper stickers?
Bumper stickers, yes. And one that he used here, which comes to mind, yes, this area is so pluralistic. And he says, you know, he was talking about the Middle East, but it applies here. What you have is a region that's pluralist without pluralists. It's plural without pluralists. That is, people who think in terms of plural, what pluralism really should lead to in terms of mutual acceptance. But the fact that it's plural, yes. Just a very last question. I had so many others, but how can you cut in any way this wonderful discussion? Are there any shortcuts? And you mentioned, Hassan, shortcuts. Are there any shortcuts here to better government, to reform? What's happening in Pakistan now seems to suggest that the incremental approach is there are too many obstacles to that, for that incremental approach, be it patronage, networks, or whatever. Is popular, is street action, is popular, are popular movements here a way to somehow jumpstart change, or, as some would argue, are they dangerous because they almost inevitably end up with something far removed from what we would consider to be democratic governance? Thoughts on this, because we have, I want to get to the audience for questions.
These are, I think the way, the in case of Pakistan, the way it has played out, it is very dangerous. Given that, yes, protest demands for accountability coming on the streets is really an integral part of democracy, and that's all very well. But in case of Pakistan, the way this has been, it seems choreographed, and Imran Khan had its own support. Mr. Qadri, who is a religious leader, had its own support from one sect within the Sunni Islam, and some Shias and others stood by him. In case of Imran Khan, he had his own support of middle-class people, young people who really want to come to support. But the way, in some form, shape, some of the anti-democratic forces started playing this has become dangerous. But I'll say something other than this protest, and just in one sentence, something else that is happening in terms of consolidation of democracy that we missed, and in any way that is in itself in some ways a shortcut. For instance, the rise of MQM, Mutahidda Qaumi Movement, as a party of middle class people was reaction to that. The number of political leaders from Awami National Party, the Pakhtun Nationalist Party, they lost about 260 of their their political workers, including members of the parliament, leading People's Party leaders who were getting killed. So there's that shortcut of democratic political parties finding out new ways, coming out of feudalism. That is also happening, and that's in, I say shortcut because that has happened in a relatively short time. But these, the way these protests are happening, yes, if they were within the domain of the rule of law, they're at one place, demanding, negotiating, it would be happy, it would have worked. And it seems they are now forced to go into that direction. There's some dialogue which is taking place, but in between, in the midst of this protest, there was some support clearly from elements within Pakistan's military establishment who wanted to support these two protests for entirely different reasons. They wanted to cut Nawaz Sharif down to size because they saw Nawaz Sharif as very clearly going for a peace process with India. They saw him kind of pushing the military back, and the military thought that by, or some elements within the military, I think military by and large, the military leadership wants to now support democracy, at least in name, but some of the elements there wanted to misuse this. If Pakistan succeeds from this protest and democracy is still survives, that will be a victory.
Quickly now, let's...
In a sentence, necessary but obviously not sufficient, the international community, in particular the West, has to stop enabling anti-democratic practices on the part of some of these elite networks.
In Pakistan, you know, there's a long and dramatic tradition of street protests. In general, I tend to think this is fairly healthy, even though I've been caught up in a few of these in unpleasant ways before. But you know, in the recent protests, when Nawaz Sharif decided not to bring out the police in order to make a strong pushback, in order to strongly push back the protesters, I don't think it was necessarily a demonstration of weakness. He certainly could have brought out the police to do so. I think it was an acknowledgement, one of the few moments in which the government seemed to sort of recognize the political dynamic that was in play, that there's a norm that has developed that you don't fire on protesters, and he made a decision, even if they're coming out the prime minister's house, the narrative is going to turn out worse for them than it is for me. And in general, I think that is one of, you know, the few bright spots to come out of what happened, and signals that I think the political elite have, you know, are, have some acknowledgement of that change. I would say in Afghanistan, I'm not I don't know that anyone is really thinking about shortcuts at the moment, because I think that, you know, the real challenge is seeing a need for conciliation in the political system at the highest levels, but also sort of further down the political system in an environment where there is going to be a fiscal crunch over the next few years. Fiscal consolidation is not an environment that is conducive to political conciliation. It's easy to get along if you've got a lot of money to slosh around. There's going to be a lot less of that. So I think seeing a stable political system in a very difficult budgetary environment is probably what should be on one of the foremost people's minds.
Moeed?
I don't see any alternative to incremental change. That's been my view for a long time. I still don't see it. That is the only way to get through this. The reason I am pessimistic and cynical is I'm not entirely sure that this kind of system will be given the space for the amount of time it requires to mature into a well-functioning democracy. And because there is a history of interruption, I'm not talking about coups or whatever, but there could be other ways where people get impatient too quickly, because the only way of getting incremental change is being incremental about it. But you're talking about 15 years, 20 years, you know, and I don't know if you're going to have that kind of space given to at least a country like Pakistan, which for other reasons remains in the headlines and, you know, things go wrong. You know, the paradox of what I've talked about here is that to me, consolidation of democracy is ultimately going to be a function of good governance, right? But I've also then said why getting to good governance is not simply a question of, oh, they should just perform better. Because there are structural reasons why these governments have been unable to perform better, some legitimate, some completely illegitimate, but they still exist now.
We didn't talk here at all about leadership, but perhaps it'll come up in the question period here, the role that leadership plays in this, whether as a catalyst or inspirational, whatever. There's a lot for us to chew on here, I'm sure you would agree, and so I now welcome the audience here. We're going to be wait until the microphone comes around, please state your name. If you have an affiliation, let's have it. And if you want to direct it to a particular individual, welcome you to do so. Let's start down here with this gentleman right here. No, right there.
Hello, my name is Nathan Shirk. I'm an intern with SAPAC, the Sindhi American Political Action Committee. And I had a question, actually probably be of interest for anyone who is a specialist on Pakistan. I'd like to hear your opinion. The MQM leader, Altaf Hussein, last week called for the creation of 20 provinces, saying that devolution would improve democracy and give more power back to the people. On the other hand, wouldn't 20 more provinces create 20 more bureaucracies that are, according to some, kleptocracies, or lead to more patronage and corruption? How do you view this proposal by the MQM leader?
I personally think that that was a great idea. This was there was many other people who have come up with this, and that's the heart of the problem that this idea is trying to resolve, is this discrepancy between the resources in Punjab and the rest of the three provinces. The Balochis and the Sindhis tragically have not been seen as equal citizens in Pakistan in many cases, especially, unfortunately, Balochis. So this idea will take away that politics of ethnic, the rivalry and distribution of assets and resources. So in principle, I think that's a great idea.
Okay.
I would say there are many simpler ways to, if your interest is redistribution and changing the patterns of redistribution, there are many simpler ways of doing that, including the NFC award that currently exists in Pakistan, rather than creating a whole new set of bureaucratic structures. And I think it is a very interesting point, because the jury is still out, I think, on the development impacts and the governance impacts of Pakistan's devolution reforms, and there's still a very painful process underway, devolving functions that have been at the center down to the provincial level for a while. And I think, you know, a few years on, we'll probably have more clarity about what impact that's actually had further down on the ground. So the question is, is the effort to improve development and governance at the lower levels, or is the element to address perceived imbalances between regions or ethnic groups or linguistic groups? And those aren't exclusive, but they are different reasons to promote that kind of structure.
Remember that Afghanistan has 34 provinces, and I've not yet heard anyone who thought that was a good idea to keep adding on provinces. Yes? Down front here, please. Right here. Brian?
Hi, Brian Vogt with USAID. I'm a democracy and governance advisor for Afghanistan and Pakistan, so quite an interesting discussion here. Just a few reactions and a question. One, on the issue of patronage and elections in Pakistan, one of the things I was interested to hear what you said, Moeed, on this, and one of the things I was struck by in the polling that was done, Gallup Pakistan did some polling in terms of why people vote for different candidates in Pakistan, and the interesting thing was, sort of for personal benefit, has actually gone down from the Musharraf era up to 2013. And so that was something, you know, looking over time, I think that was a positive progress there. Certainly people expect benefits, but that was an important change. One of the things on Sarah's point on the elections 2 years ago, remember where we were. We were questioning whether even an election would take place, whether Musharraf would, not Musharraf, but whether Karzai would try to stay in power. Tokyo Mutual Accountability Framework identified a few key things, one of which was the passage of electoral laws by Parliament. It happened. It wasn't enough, clearly. But there were a handful of things that the international community said needed to happen. We can argue whether those were sufficient enough or not, and clearly, you know, they didn't solve the problems there. But some of those things did happen. One of the things we need to make sure we don't ignore, I think, and we talked about this a little bit, beyond government is the role of civil society and media in both countries. I know Josh had mentioned civil society before, but this is one success story, I think, in both countries, is the development of those two institutions and holding government accountable. And the last one I'll just leave on a question. Important issue on patronage that many of y'all mentioned. And the question I have is you know, what recommendations do you all have in terms of what the U.S. can do in the development, in my role in terms of USAID, in the development world in terms of decreasing, trying to foster an environment that decreases opportunities for patronage, because it continues to be a big problem in both countries.
Quickly on the last one, we've been doing a lot of work, I mean, particularly on corruption and security, but there's a paper, I don't know if you saw it, but it has a whole list of tools, because that question keeps coming up. Now, we carefully produce this in a way that it was sort of knowledge production. Here are the tools that are available. Then the notion is, as applied to a specific country, you know, you would select from the menu and you would use different, you know, windows of opportunity, et cetera. But let's get real. You guys up against the CIA don't actually, you know, account for much. I mean, in terms of a revenue stream, you know, USAID has been a very important revenue stream that was captured by members of the kleptocratic networks, but the CIA was also a significant one in Pakistan, military assistance, swamps, you know. So this is a whole of government issue that's got to get hammered out. So it keeps getting shunted off to USAID. Oh, corruption, that's a USAID issue. You know, you guys spend some more money to, you know, do anti-corruption programs or something like that, instead of, wow, how could we maybe spend less money so as to not provide a revenue stream, and how can we mainstream this consideration across the interagency so that our provision of military assistance, the way we interact with partners in these countries in terms of what types of venues we see them at, and how we use our visa denial powers. I mean, there's a whole range of things that could be done, but that effort, I have the scars to show for it. I've been through that effort, and we lost, basically. So in the absence of that kind of effort, yes, it's honorable for USAID to try to improve its piece of that puzzle, but it's not going to make that much difference.
Can I just say, in defense of sort of the civilian assistance, I think it has done some important things in the Pakistani context. The problem is that the sea is too big. And so you get lost very quickly because you are rightly telling me, and I agree with you, that these are the 10 things we've improved. But just because the sea is big is not a reason not to do those 10 things. So, you know, I would say continue doing what you're doing, and civilian assistance has done good things. But overall, it may not seem much. It may not make a difference, which to me is fine. But your question about patronage, let me just say, one of these times, Marvin, we need to have a panel and sit down a hypothetical Pakistani prime minister and Afghan president and ask them to govern well for a day. Let's see how far we get. In terms of the patronage, I think the number one game changer that's sort of happening, and political parties and political systems are having a very hard time to catch up with, is the urbanization phenomena. And tied to that, again, sort of this communication, information revolution, and all of that. I think if we can get a handle on this, you know, for instance, a practical tool is census in Pakistan. I think that'll change things more than any single act. Some of the things we have to catch up with in terms of what is happening to societies demographically and in terms of this information stuff. And then maybe the aspirations and the delivery start coming somewhat in sync, even though I think the gap is still too huge.
Yes, back over there.
Right there. Hi, my name is Zara. I work at an international NGO called IREX. And my question is, I'm going to talk about the airplane incident with Rehman Malik. So that video, I don't know if anyone
has... Why don't you say just...
Okay, so basically, a PIA airplane was delayed for 2 hours, supposedly because he delayed the entire process. He kind of just waltzed over 2 hours later, and the passengers on the plane had to wait. And when he got there, they didn't let him board. They told him, you can't be on this plane. How dare you? Shame on you, et cetera, et cetera. That whole thing was caught on video and shared very widely, made it to Reddit, et cetera, et cetera. So I guess my question is, how does that tie in with the whole information revolution that you're talking about? And to Mr. White, is that a good representation of where democracy in Pakistan is headed?
Good question. Gives me a chance to explain what is always an unpopular comment on my part. Information revolution is without a doubt a net positive in terms of democracy and politics. There's no question about it. The kind of things that media exposes, the kind of things the politicians have to worry about, the militaries have to worry about, bureaucrats, there's no debate that it's a net positive. You need to harness that. We need to make sure that you know, every time Rehman Malik does this, is brought up. No question around it. Now, there is another aspect of this, which I've deliberately exaggerated to explain what I'm saying. That is the ARYs and Express Newses of the world in Pakistan, where you've got people sitting as the most popular anchors with the highest viewership, essentially batting for a political party, openly saying that I want to kick out this government and I will do whatever it takes to get you there, right? It is about a state which is already discredited, the concept of the state and government, whoever is in government must be a thief kind of idea. And there, the media explaining very well why the protesters have a right to do what they're doing, but not explaining that the state has the right to challenge them when they enter the red zone, which has been barred for them to enter, when they break the fence of the parliament, because that is not allowed. The reverse conversation is also important. If you want to leave the state just enough space to do what they can lawfully do, but challenging the state on what they used to do and should not be doing, that's absolutely positive. There's no debate about that. But to Brian's comment, huge success, independence of media, absolutely. Now we need to make sure that that comes in sync with the goal of improvement of democracy and governance. Positive harness and negative we need to challenge. That's basically the argument I make.
Moeed, when you say that there's no debate on the communications revolution, maybe a little debate.
Okay.
People are going to point out the way in which this very media has been manipulated.
Yeah.
The way in which in Pakistan today, one looks very hard to see a spectrum of opinion.
Mm-hmm.
There's a mindset here, a mainstream thinking which crowds out everything else. Mm-hmm. So leave a little room for debate then.
No. I think we're agreeing. What I'm saying is this is the negative potential that you're talking about, which I think we should challenge. Absolutely.
Yes.
But then the media, in terms of the positive, is Rahman Malik. It's also bringing out rape cases. It's, you know, doing a lot of other things which are important.
Oh, absolutely.
But I think I'm exactly saying what you're saying, which is that the state needs to be left enough space to at least do what is their legal right without being challenged.
Okay. All the way back there, lady, young gal with the red blouse.
Yes.
Hi, everyone. My name is Neha Ansari. I'm now with the Carnegie Institute, but I used to be a deputy editor for the National Desk at the Express Tribune. So this all is very recent and firsthand for me.
Oops.
And and that's exactly why this is actually the perfect time for me to make the remarks that I really wanted to, was that this the role that media is playing, I know firsthand every single day how we created this protest that's happening right now. The advisories, quote unquote, we get from the ICE and the GHQ every day. We change headlines. We inserted words in headlines to make this look bigger and better. And there were pictures of empty chairs which Imran Khan was addressing, which we censored, polls that we censored. So this is obviously Chatham House rules, please. I'm just trying to say
it's
that
it's being recorded.
It is for at least this moment.
But that's fine. I mean, I can actually say this openly. I'm writing an article on it, so it's okay for now. But
and obviously, you're looking for another job too.
No, I used to fight with them every day about this. It's fine. But my point is that this impatience that you talked about, I would go further and say that we are creating this impatience through the media to lessen that very space that you spoke of. And so this impatience also is an illusion. That may be an extreme word. I'm not saying it doesn't exist. There are roots there, but we are feeling it every day. And the whole point was that, again, this is a very urban phenomenon. We need to understand that the rest of of Pakistan has only PTV, who are still telling you how to stitch, for example, like that's what PTV still shows. So again, my point is that the media has a very terrible role to play in this. The impatience and this idea of the populist movement is not exactly accurate. And when you talked about structure, like maybe there's a structural problem. Yes, there is, because there hasn't been any space. We had our first elections in 1971. I mean, again, I think we all have a part to play in having short-term memories and impatience. And I just, again, think the structural issue is, it just needs more time, as we talked about, for building institutions.
Thank you.
I would say, I expect it will become harder and harder for the government or for particular groups of political or business elites to control the message in an environment where not only have a lot more channels represented by a diverse range of business and political interests, but you also have individuals who can get a message out very quickly. So I know that's, I think that's over the slightly longer term. It's very difficult for governments to control that message unless they control some of these key channels.
And can I also say that I think what the media has done is that perceptions now matter much more than reality. So we can call it an illusion, but the fact is that illusion becomes reality because there's been a perception created about it. And medias do this all over the world. It's not only sort of the Pakistani media. But I think I wouldn't miss the sort of forest for the trees by saying that this is all created. I think there is something underneath which is pushing this, and it's being exaggerated because of the perception that's being created. It's not about, you know, 30,000 or 25 or empty or not. Otherwise, if you have nothing underneath, you can't, you know, it's very difficult to sort of keep something going. So it's that, but fundamentally you're right. And that's why I'm saying that space is being constrained in a way that we need to sort of make sure that, you know, we're in sync.
Okay, gentlemen here, Mr. Butt.
Yes, sir. My name is Kambi Butt. I'm with the Pakistani Spectator, and my question is that who have failed democracy in Pakistan? I would like to remind you the statement of Javed Hashmi that Imran Khan was just reading a script. So if the people who write script for him are those the people who want democracy to fail in Pakistan, it's a Nawaz Sharif. When Nawaz Sharif came, every economic indication was up. He brought foreign exchange reserve from 6 billion to 14 billion just within 1 year. People have very high expectation. He was attacking on unemployment. I mean, he did every best thing for the country after he came into power. But still, there are some element in Pakistani politics or in Pakistani institutions who don't like to support democracy. And everybody, of course, you know most of that, who is that institution. So is that institution more, their ego is more important than democracy or welfare of average person? Thanks.
Okay. Thank you.
I mean, that context is happening. I tend to agree with the general view that you reflect that both Pakistan People's Party and the previous government, it was a different democratic transition in from 2008 to 2013. There were many successes. A massive or major constitutional amendment that had taken place. In a step-by-step fashion, some improvements. Yes, by and large, the corruption continued. There were some other issues. Same in case of Nawaz Sharif. I think he started off quite well. His major focus on some of the energy projects and others, and people voted for him for one basic reason. They thought, and I've never supported Nawaz Sharif in political ways when I was in Pakistan, or never voted for him. However, I'll give him this credit. People voted for him because they thought that Nawaz, especially in Punjab, that he will be able to deliver because some of the major projects that he was behind worked out. I think it is true that some of the other institutions, including, again, not military necessarily as an institution anymore, because they have learned their lessons. What happened to Musharraf was because of the rise of judiciary. And I think Musharraf was humiliated, and that was also an indirect way for the military to learn their lessons. I think many there have learned their lessons, but there are some people who within the institutions are not, I think, towing the line. So that is an issue. It will take some time, like the Turkish model. Turkish model in Pakistan has become kind of somewhat controversial. The model is you need to, I'll support what my other colleagues have very articulately mentioned, the civilian government has to improve through governance. And that will increase their space. That will lessen the possibility for elements within the military establishment, elements within the religious parties, who are, by the way, as dangerous. There are people within Pakistani religious groups, including religious political parties, who actually don't believe in democracy. And they are as big a threat as anyone else. Nawaz Sharif, only through dialogue, negotiations, will expand that space, and I think there still should be hope within this system with structural reforms, some level constitutional amendments, picking up better people to be cabinet ministers, picking up better bureaucrats, and that transition is happening very slowly, but it is happening.
Okay. Yes, gentlemen here.
Fadi Boris Fatemi, Oxfordshire Group. Thank you so much to the panel for an interesting discussion. I want to follow up on religion. The Quran for believers is very clear on the concept of government. For those who follow the Quran, it teaches you something about how to conduct your daily life. And as far as governance, it's very simple. It says, govern with the consent of the governed. Now, that is as wonderful a concept of democracy as you can possibly have. So what's happened? How has this been hijacked? We can talk about all these other different factions and factors and things of this nature. But what happened? The religious parties with their extremism, don't they follow what the Quran tells them to follow?
I think we need a lot of time to answer that question. But in very brief, I will absolutely agree with you. And there are many leading experts on Islamic law and Islamic democracy in the United States, elsewhere, even Tariq Ramadan, Abdul Karim Sarush, you name a person, whether from Iran or Middle East, and they have expanded upon this idea that there is nothing in principle which is contradictory between the democratic principles and some elements within the Islamic context. Of course, not the liberal democratic ideals. The liberal view is slightly, there's some issue and tension there. However, the general participatory thing, and as you mentioned, the idea of shura, and looking at some of the principles of governance, there's one, if any one of you is interested in looking at Islamic concept of democracy or something closest to that, or Islamic concept of governance, you need to actually just read one letter if you have time, which is a letter by Ali ibn Abi Talib, the fourth caliph of Islam, to Malik ibn Ashraf, who was the governor of Egypt, or designated. The kind of details they go through about governance are very, very insightful. What has gone wrong? Why that has not been implemented? These monarchies, which we know which countries, and the way this autocratic tendency with monarchies and with because Muslim empires were built also around the same ideas of power and greed. And that's so obvious in many countries of the Middle East. So that is what has gone wrong. The central principles, the Muslim scholarship, if I may say, has degenerated over a period of time, that these major principles, which were so certain, so clear, so simple, are now, it seems, they were never even part of the Islamic discourse.
I would disagree somewhat. I think the Quran is not very clear about the concept of governance. I think it has a number of principles, and there's been a very robust and interesting and sophisticated debate about how to apply those principles to governance for a long time. But the Quran, I think, does figure very prominently in Pakistani discussions of governance, which is interesting. I would also say to the religious parties, I've spent a fair amount of time with Pakistan's religious parties, and it's a little bit disturbing to me sometimes, but I often find that they have a more pluralist, procedural, and substantive vision of democracy than some of other Pakistan's parties, like the PTI or others. Now, that's not always the case, but it is interesting how even parties that have a very clear Islamic vision of where they want to go often have, I think, bought into the concept of the nation state and to the idea that elections are, you know, the procedural side of democracy is very important, and that Islam demands a certain kind of substantive democracy. And you can debate exactly whether you think that that's a good or beneficial vision, but my experience is that they've given it a lot more thought and can articulate it more clearly, and in some ways may be more committed to that than some of other of Pakistan's political actors.
Josh, even the Salafist tradition here?
I don't think there are that many Salafis in Pakistan as such. And certainly there are, I mean, I've certainly talked to people and I come away from the conversations with the sense that this person believes in democracy for very instrumental reasons. You know, we're going to use democracy as stage one of a seven-stage plan to turn Pakistan into a certain kind of Islamic state and then a global caliphate. I mean, certainly get that perspective from some people, but I think it's actually remarkable if you take a step back, the degree to which Pakistan's sort of religious political actors have bought into the nation, into the idea of the Pakistani state as the vehicle for not only political transformation but social transformation.
So why don't they get votes? Why don't they get votes?
Why don't they get votes? Because of the patronage dynamics. I think they're not going to deliver.
Well, I think, you know, at its core, and we're going to wind up now. At its core, there's something universal here, and that is that virtually all people want to have a say in their destiny. They want to have their interests represented, and they want to hold accountable those who have power and are exercising that power in pursuant of various interests. So on that very basic level, you can say that there is a commonality here
across all kinds of shores. When we look at our own democracy and we look at it carefully, there are so many implicit values in it, which leads you to believe, too, that in an Islamic state, you can absorb those values, too, without violating the basic principles of much of what we've been talking about here. So I want to thank everyone for coming, and I'm sure you agree with me that the level of discussion here, the richness of this discussion, is the very sort of thing that we all, when we talk about having things aired in this town and in analytically and so on, I think that this certainly represents the very best we can offer. So please.